Good morning, everyone, and happy Thursday. Well, if you're in Sydney, it is a very dreary and drab day. And I don't know about you, but when I see bad weather, it kind of, you know, puts my feeling down a little bit. But being on this live this morning, I'm excited. So my feelings are excited and ready to interview and catch up with this incredible lady. So first of all, let me introduce Catherine Brown. She is the executive assistant to the CEO and the MD at Ingham Group. And I have to say that word really slowly, Catherine, because I get it. La, 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 la. Anyway, AKA Ingham Chicken. So welcome, Catherine. How are you?
Yes, really well. Thanks, Mish. It's really wonderful to see you.
Oh, no. It's been forever. It's kind of like this whole COVID. Have I seen you in 2022 or no?
I don't
2021?
So. No. I've seen you on lives and I've seen you, but I don't know. We haven't seen each other in person, no.
It's bizarre how quick, I mean, it is November and it's nearly December this year. I mean, it's just been a, yeah. But we're nearly there and we nearly made it. Now, the incredible Catherine is joining the Australian Admin Awards on the advisory panel, which I'm very excited because she's super talented. She has had a career in the admin space and truly is incredible. And I think, is it 3 years now you've been at Ingham?
Actually, it feels like that, but it's only two.
Oh, so you started just before. So, guys, it's really interesting. This is going to be a great conversation because Catherine, it's only 2 years, so we've had nearly 2 years of COVID. And during that time, she's had two CEOs. So talk to me about joining a business, you know, because you were you in property and share? What was the business you worked
for?
No,
prior to Ingham's, I was working with GFG Alliance, which is the Gupta family group in the mining manufacturing space. And then I moved over to Ingham's about 2 years ago. And it's an interesting industry, the agribusiness industry, but it's fabulous. And on a daily basis, we're feeding the nations of Australia and New Zealand, which is a wonderful feeling. Yes, but it's been a wonderful experience.
Yeah, and to change industries as well, I mean, but it's a credit to you because, you know, as an EA at your level, you're going in there with a leadership hat on and you've got that business acumen as well, which is really important for the listeners to know because we can change and adapt the industries if we have the skill set, the mindset and the capability behind us, which truly you have, and you've settled into that role and you've navigated two CEOs and, you know, two lockdowns, well, probably two lockdowns I would call in Sydney, but you are a national business and also, as you said, New Zealand. So it's obviously provided lots of challenges for both you personally and the business.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think one of the key things that has really assisted has been the fit that I've had with, very fortunately, with both CEOs. So I was went into the business and we were very much on the trajectory of growing after being listed in 2000. We became a listed company in 2016. And then that has its challenges moving from a family business, which got a legacy of 100 years plus, and a lot of brand associated with that history. And then moving into the space of being an ASX 200 listed. So that was a really interesting change because I'd worked for professional services, private companies, and now moving into the public company space was in itself a challenge with a board.
Those board papers.
That was new to me. And then having the change in CEO, which I think if you, to your point, Mish, I think with the toolkit that we have as admin professionals, I think that really is, if you've got your toolkit, you've got your support network, you can actually do anything. So I found that each role that I've been in, I've just added to the toolkit. So by the time I got to Ingham's, I had a fairly fully fledged toolkit. So instead.
Yeah. And that's the experience that came behind it. And you've supported prior to Ingham some incredible leaders. So you've learned along the way, you've gathered the experience, and you know, it's hanging out with those right people, which we talk about your community. So I want to kind of, talk about something exciting that's been happening with you. I don't know whether it's exciting or crazy. I don't think I could do it, but you entered into, well, you started an MBA and oh my gosh.
I did.
It is it's incredible because you're doing a master's in business administration with AIM. Firstly, how do you do it? My brain I don't have the capacity to do that. But, you know, juggling a career and in a leadership role at a huge company and then trying to study at, you know, do an MBA. First of all, what encouraged you to do it and why, and how are you feeling about that whole process?
Well, yes, it's a huge challenge, which I have undertaken mostly eyes wide open. I don't think I fully expected the length and breadth of it, but the main decision to do the MBA was because I'm at a point in my career where I wanted to add value, I wanted to upskill, I wanted to future-proof. And I think this is a conversation going on quite extensively at the moment, certainly in the admin space, but I think widely in the professional space. Mm-hmm. I had thought about doing some further education for a while and hadn't really understood where that those areas would be. And then from conversations I've had with a mentor and my network, and I thought this was probably the best option for me. It really is very supported by my work environment and by my boss and the company. And certainly they're looking to grow leaders in their business at the moment. And they support me being part of the exec team, me having a seat at the table. But I felt that I wanted to do this MBA in order so that I felt validated to be at that table. So for me, it's a huge learning curve, not only in the actual space of the subjects that I'm taking on, but it's also me having the confidence now to be able to step up and add extra value in the situation that I'm already in, which I'm very blessed to be in. But it's exciting, but it's a huge undertaking, and it is a juggle. It's certainly something that I probably have each subject that I'm doing. I'm learning to navigate the time management, getting those assignments in on time, and also reaching out for help actually because it's being supported by my business, and I'm actually able to write a lot of the papers on current situations. I'm actually able to get a lot of assistance, which is increasing my learning curve exponentially.
Wow.
That's fun.
Yeah, and I think it's an interesting point because we, with Emma Kate, we had on the other day, she's doing a mini MBA with Your Excellency, which is based in the UK, but the way it works is really good. And she wanted, I know a few people have wanted to do the full MBA, so I congratulate you, but they kind of got a bit hesitant because of the time and not the investment, but the time you needed to invest into it, because it does, it does take away those extra minutes and hours that we have in the day after, you know, working a 10, 12-hour day. And I think it is great to see, again, Catherine, someone like you and people in the admin space that are investing in themselves and the businesses are supporting it, because we have to really, you know, have the conversation with our executives, you know, where's my career going? What am I doing? What do I want to learn? And then saying, these are my thoughts and can you support it in me? And that support is so incredible when a business does that, because they value you, and that's really, really important.
And I feel very fortunate in that respect. Certainly having gone through the changes in the business, even within the time that I've been there, but I've really seen how much the business cares for its people. And I think that makes, to your point, it makes such a difference when you are in a company that really supports your well-being, not only your day-to-day well-being, but your future well-being. And the conversations are happening throughout the business at the moment, actually. And it's just wonderful. And people are responding. It's changing the culture. It's changing for the better. The culture's great. The people are wonderful. But it's very much an investment piece going forward for the company. So I'm really excited to be on that journey with them.
And that is a great thing, because you are in a business that you've got from the factory workers all the way up to the exec level. So you, yes, you've got different bandwidth, different salaries, different demographics of employees, you know, yes, which is great. And that is great to see. I mean, with all we've gone through for the last 2 years, to hear a business that is supporting their employees and, you know, really focusing on, you know, giving them more love, as we call it, is really, really important. Because your employees are the core part of your business. And, you know, I don't know about you, but I'm reading everywhere that they, a lot of businesses now can't get good staff. So you need to retain that staff. You need to give them the love and provide the loyalty with it. So that's fantastic. It must be fun to work there at the moment then.
Yes, yes, absolutely. No, I've certainly landed where I'm feeling really comfortable, very supported. I'm excited about the future with the company. And to see where the MBA will take me.
Because it's space. It's such an interesting thing, because, I mean, you know, we've been around just a couple years in this space. I'll say a couple. But where we first started from, you know, to now be able to have the ability to do MBAs in our roles, because there's no career path for an EA. It's like, you know, I'm working really, really hard on that advocacy piece that a person can go to their Year 10 careers advisor and say, hey, I want to be the EA at Ingham's. How do I get there? But, you know, and there was nothing in our days. We didn't have that. It's like, oh, we'll throw you in the job and you can learn it. Or here's a typewriter, because we did have typewriters. And now to see, you know, organisations like AIM, there's a lot of tertiary institutions here in Australia, and also your excellency with the MBA supporting us with it. It really cements our profession as a leading profession now, which is what we've had to work really hard for, and also sees us as just not an admin. We're now seen as leaders in the business, which is incredible.
Absolutely, Mish. And I think that's a really important point too. And I've heard some of the other wonderful advisory panel members who've been interviewed. And I think we've all got a common theme in that the profession has changed. It is a profession. There's been no clear career path, and it certainly wasn't something that was I ever imagined that would be encouraged. I've found myself in it, but I've also had, the imagination to think, well, how can this be created in a way that not only works and adds value for myself, but also adds value for the area that I'm working in? And I think to create it, and I think a lot of us in this space are actually creators, because we've created these positions, and we've certainly in this generation and at this moment, we have lifted this profession out of the old model. And I think going forward, it's the boundaries are lifted totally and smashed in some cases. I mean, I love the interview with Justin, because he speaks about that strategic piece, which is certainly the area that I'm looking to move into, and I think that's the world's your oyster now. I think it's just wonderful.
It is, and you can actually, and I think what we're seeing now is you can actually have a choice. Do I want to be transactional, or do I want to be strategic? Whereas in the past there was no choices. I think with the global skills matrix that has come out, and it is backed by the World Administrators Alliance, which is our global governing body, which a lot of people didn't know they existed. Like to see, it's just a simple 5 different levels, but to see in that matrix the different skills and tasks that we actually do in our roles, and people go, you actually do that? It's like, yeah, I do. Like, you know, and it's funny, a document, it substantiates the importance of our roles as leaders and as a leading profession as well, which is incredible. So we've still got lots more work to do, but it's slow and steady wins the race, isn't it?
Look, absolutely. And look, when I started, I had some time working overseas and internationally with the UN. And when I started, I was a clerk. I was actually, my title was clerk. And I was considering, I actually never really heard that word before, but realizing what it was, and I thought, that's really interesting. But the longer I was with the UN for about 10, 11 years, and before I had this lovely time away internationally. And during that time, what you were required to do for that title was nothing you were not just typing. You were organizing conferences for delegates of 196 countries. You were, you know, involved in proofreading incredibly complex policy documents. You were, you know, dealing with royal households in protocol and things like that. And that was under the title of it changed a little bit, but yeah, it was under the clerk level 5 or something like that, which was really. And I remember when I was preparing to return to Australia and applying for roles, and I thought, I can't put this title on my CV. This is just not going to wash. So it was. So even globally, I think the positions in administration have changed, and rightly so. And I think it's part of this recognizing where what this position actually is, which is quite a crucial and pivotal position in a company or in any business, actually.
Yeah, it is. Mm. Well, that do you think that your own experience just made you fall in love with this profession? Like, I mean, 10 years there and then doing everything, you know, from writing policy documents and speeches to organizing events and then also doing the typing as well. I mean, did that really just, you know, I mean, you had such a broad experience and you did have the strategic and you did have the transactional, not knowing that was the function you were doing. But it must be, was it
no, fun? It was amazing. It was an amazing experience. And again, it was taking all opportunities. It was saying yes to everything and being completely immersed and just enjoying the experience, because it really, and they were, you know, the UN at that time was going through a period of change as well, because, you know, there was still the title of the clerk, but there was so much other work being done, particularly to forward the causes of the particular UN agencies. I worked with one of the nuclear agencies, which was fascinating.
Oh, wow. Yes.
There was a mix of the technical meetings that we were organising, as well as the administration side. So the how much money each country was going to be contributing, and you know how they were going to be organising future conferences and things like that. So it was a real mix, and you jumped in and you did whatever you needed to do, in whatever language you could possibly come up with.
So do you speak a few languages?
Look, I was dabbling in a few of them. German was the main language in Austria, so I could certainly survive. I'm not as fluent as I was, but yeah, it was fascinating. It was such a melting pot of people from all walks of life or nationalities, but we all got on and did. Certainly in the secretariat, you were jack of all trades. You were able to master some, but you were jack of all trades, and that was what it was about, which increased my experience. And certainly when I came back to Australia, it was then having to work out how to use all of that and where that would fit. So that was another experience. Yeah.
So what did you – okay, so here's a fun one. Like, you know, when you came back to Australia and you were applying for roles –
yeah.
Were you applying for like EA and PA roles? And what did you put on your resume that you worked at the UN? I mean, putting a clerk, you know, when we think of clerks now, I mean, do they exist in Australia? I don't think they still exist in Australia. I mean, but.
Well, no, it's a bit like the use of the word secretary. I don't think that exists anywhere at the moment in the history books, maybe. It was a little bit of a challenge to describe and to relate it. To relate what I'd been doing when I came back to Australia, because there really was this sense of, well, we don't really understand what, not everyone, but some a lot of positions that I applied for, I really did have to explain that quite thoroughly and to relate it to the Australian market, because I found them very different. It was kind of like coming back in time, to be honest, when I came back to Australia. Kind of the clerk era, but a little bit further.
this again relates back to, you know, the global skills matrix, but also what we do in our roles. It's about the skills and the tasks. It's not about the title. And there has been a big shift. And, you know, obviously when we spoke to Justin before, like, he was a C-suite EA and now he's executive business partner, and that's changed his positioning at the boardroom table, his strategic voice, all those kind of things. Yes. And I think the next conversation will be interesting to have now is with recruiters, because often the recruiters just look at your title and not look at what you actually do. That they'll skim through and go, oh, she's the EA to such and such, but what does she actually do for it? Because the title versus in the task is so varied in every industry and role. And I think I would love to see also that when the recruiters bring out their salary, annual salary reports, you know how they bring out those salary reports, that what they do is that they're grading, that they're attaching the title with the skills and the tasks, not the salary now, or looking at it in a different way. Because I think this is a great example, even though it was a while back when you returned to Australia from the UN, it's still important and still happens today. And, you know, I'll have recruiters reach out to me and say, hey, I need a C-suite EA. And I go, yes, and what do you actually want them to do? It's, and you know, who are they going to support and what is the fit about? And I think that dialogue and conversation, we need to change it. And it is changing. I mean, the education bit as well, like it's now becoming a conversation that the admin professionals are having with their employees. I want to be further educated. I want to learn more. And it doesn't have to always be going to do tertiary studies. It could be upskilling in an Excel spreadsheet if you're supporting a CFO and you don't know how to read financials. It could be going out and doing a confidence building course or finding a mentor. And I think that's where the narrative's changing. And I'm excited by it. And it's, you know, it is a hard slog, but we've got to continue the conversation and have conversations with people like yourself and the advisory panel who are leading the way in these conversations. Mm-hmm. We need to open it more. And it's, oh my gosh, I can talk about this all day because I just love it.
No, it's wonderful, exciting. Oh, look, I have to make a call out to Roxanne Calder at S10 because she's published a book, Seven, How to Employability, basically. And in fact, I've got it. Oh, no, I've got it here somewhere. I've been reading it. But she advocates hugely for the pieces. It's beyond your title, and it's about the education piece. It's about those skills that you build. It's not about the title, which is what you're saying.
And I
think that's an important point to make about you know, in my case, doing the MBA it's a massive stretch goal, let me tell you. But it's there are other ways to educate, to upskill, to it's even about the people you're associating with. I think that's a huge and I think that's the beautiful thing about the Admin Awards, is because you're creating that space for people to tap into, to be able to get those connections, to have those conversations, to be able to understand, oh, maybe I can do this or this, or maybe I can, you know, join this network, or you know, it's about the people you associate as well with. And I think it is an exciting time at the moment for the admin professionals, because there is so many opportunities that are available, and also to create, because we're not bound by titles, we're not bound by you know, this is your job description, that's it. It's, well, actually great, that's a good start, but I can also embellish that, and I can show my value, and I can lead.
Yeah,
I think that's the difference now. It is a leadership position, because you are leading. You're leading by example. You're leading by what you're doing. You're learning the business. You're able to be in that role that is a driving force, as opposed to just being put upon.
Yeah. Well, there's that trust, because they're seeing you in a leadership role. There's that trust there. They're allowing you now to make those decisions that traditionally, you know, an ELT team would make or a CEO would make, because you have that capability and you're just not seen as just the admin, which I hate using. But it's that narrative that's changing very, very quickly. And I think it's really important to mention as well, you know, when the Global Skills Matrix was put together, they identified 160 different job titles in the admin profession. Now, that is just, you know, because we think of EA, when you talk admin, immediately everyone goes executive assistant. But my golly gosh, 160. And so then that truly represents the importance of removing the title and looking at actually functionality. What are your skills that you offer, and then what are your tasks that you're going to do in the role? And that is the most imperative thing. And then you can work out the salary, and the title can be the last thing. I mean, you can call yourself whatever you want, but it's about the value that you're bringing to the business. And, you know, as I call them, what are your superpowers? Because we are all very different in what we can do. I mean, I just don't like doing board papers, I'm saying, so I take my hat off to you. Well, absolutely love that. And it's like with the event side, like some people, you know, love doing events, so that is your superpower. So hone on that, work on that, and showcase that skill to the business, that is what you do really, really well. And I think when you get to a point that you really, really, really do well in that thing, that's when you're seen as a leader. And it doesn't matter about the title. And we need to change the narrative. We need to have different conversations, which is really, and that's where the education piece comes in. It's about, you know, the business supporting, because traditionally, you know, they send the sales leaders on sales courses and conferences all the time. Where does the admin get to go? Nowhere. She doesn't get to, he or she doesn't get to do anything. So it's that investment piece as well, because we invest in our leaders, but do we invest in us?
That's such a crucial and key element, I think. And that, look, I think, Mish, also too, it comes with experience and it comes with knowing your self-worth. It's knowing that you have your own back. You know, it's about being confident to actually have those conversations.
Yeah.
It does come with experience. I know, I mean, for, you know, certainly in my earlier days in my career, there's no way I would have had these conversations. And I certainly didn't have that self-belief and that very confident self-worth. That has come with time and experience. And I think I would say to certainly the admin professionals who are starting on their journey, it will come.
Yes.
It will definitely come.
But don't
rush it. There are people that you can reach out to have those conversations and have and get some tips and hints and who can guide you in a in a mental capacity. That's, I think that was a little, not really necessarily, it's been important in my life, but I think it's also something I've sought as opposed to was available. So I think we're certainly providing that in this space now, which I think is very helpful for everyone coming through.
It is, and I think that's a really great point to mention. Everyone on the advisory panel at the Australian Admin Awards do mentor someone in the admin space, whether it be internally or externally. So if you're listening today or you've listened to any of our interviews and one of these amazing advisory panel, you know, inspired you, reach out to them and ask them, hey, can you give up some time? Because that's part of the giving back piece. And it's also about that all of you believe in this profession and you love it and you're so passionate. And the advocacy piece is really, really important because we want to support and encourage the young ones that are coming up through the ranks to give them the right navigation track, because we never had that. We were just like thrown in and it was like but we want to give you the right support. And I think it's also you know, we've learned it over time. We've had failures and we've fallen down, but we've got back up because we love what we do. And I think that's the most important thing, because, you know, coming into the profession, you just don't click your fingers overnight and you're sitting at the boardroom table and supporting the EA to the CEO. There's a path, or there's things that you've got to learn along the way. And I do love that these young kids, and I'm going to call them young kids because I'm probably old enough to be some of their mothers, but I love them that they're, you know, they're goal setting already and they're writing their career paths down and they go, right, by the time I'm 30, I want to do this. By the time I'm 40, I think this is fantastic, because we didn't do that. I mean, I don't know when you first started. There was no goal setting. There was no KPIs. Like, that was for the rest of the business.
But also too, I mean, as we spoke about before, there was actually, there's certainly no one said to me, oh, you know, an admin professional as a career choice. I was thinking, what? Okay, you know, it's something I've actually fallen into. I love it, but I've fallen into it because I've got that, one of the values of service, and I, you know, you can, you can easily, it's not an easy profession, I must admit. It's something that, you know, you either like it or you don't, but it's certainly nothing that was on offer. It was more like, well, okay, then if, you know, will all else fails, you can be a secretary. It's like, what? Really? Okay. Whereas now I think it's a conscious choice. It is a conscious choice of a really rewarding career. I mean, some of those fabulous advisory panel members have got amazing careers from starting off as PAs, EAs. Yeah. Even the where they've got to with their EA careers, it's quite incredible. Oh,
it's amazing. And you know, Tracy Clark's a great example. She's just had her first child late. Actually, I don't even know how. She's in her early 40s, I'm going to say. Trace, I'm so sorry. I forget your age. But she had an incredible career because, you know, she was on private jets. She was going shopping, you know, for diamond rings for her bosses. She was doing all these incredible things. She was single and she traveled the world. So the world is your oyster. And it's obviously decisions that you make, you know, if you want to get married and have children younger, then, you know, that positioning. Because being in this role, depending on who you're supporting, the business and where you are at your life, you are going to have to do the hard yards and you are going to have to do the 60, 80, sometimes 100 hour weeks. You know, if you're doing a merger and acquisition, like, you know, or board papers, you've got a huge book, but you are knee deep in the trenches and you're working those long hours. So yes. I think also it's moved from the clocking in, clocking out of the typing secretary mm-hmm. days where, you know, that's not what it's about, because it is now a profession. So like any industry or any leader, you have to put the time and the effort in. So it's, I think that's also, the rewards are there. And yes, we've got an incredible advisory panel. I just like, you inspire me every day, and I think when I'm having a bad day, I just need to pick up the phone to one of you, and you remind me why you're in the role and why I'm doing what I'm doing. So it's incredible. And so, Catherine, you know, 2022 is only, is it 6 weeks away? I can't even believe that. What's on the cards apart from...
Oh, is it?
I know. I was just, what's on the cards for, you know, either from a business or personal perspective, apart from, you know, doing the MBA, because that is going to consume a lot of your time. Anything planned for you for 2022?
I think the main focus is, well, the main focus will be to continue with the MBA program. I'm hooked, so I'm going to keep going. We have some exciting things coming up in the business. We've got our we're continuing on growing with the business, and I'm very excited to be more involved as my time allows. And, hopefully I can get some travel in if it's possible to visit family and friends and try and get an overseas trip. But, keep on keeping on, I think, is the... Yeah. Is...
well, I guess... Just sorry. A quickie, the MBA, is it all remote based learning? I think that's an interesting thing. Or will you go into a physical classroom at some point?
Well, interestingly, it is online. Okay. However, they're offering, AIM is offering a summer school, which I'm hoping to attend in January for one of the subjects, which is a chance to be able to be face to face with facilitators and fellow students, and you can fast track some of the subjects, which I think is wonderful. Having not studied formally before, I'm finding the online manageable
because it is going to be
fitted into the time that I allocate each day and week. However, I do miss that face-to-face, the classroom style, which I have utilized in previous courses that I've done, just sort of one-day courses. So that will be a really... I'm hoping that will actually be a way that I can fast track some of the study, because I'm keen to learn, but I'm also keen to be able to achieve the qualification in a reasonable amount of time. so at the moment, I think it'll be about the sort of 2.5 to 3 year mark, which is fine. It's not a rush. And I'm doing this primarily for myself and with the support of the business, obviously, but it's certainly to be immersed in the learning and to really get as much out of it as possible. So, if I can do some residential summer schools, I'll do that, which will be a lot of fun to meet fellow students rather than Zooming them.
So there'll be no going to the beach or sitting, you know, by the pool at a resort for you, or in the classroom by the sound of it.
Probably in the classroom, yeah, exactly. Well, if I could combine it, that would work.
Amazing. Well, we've come to our 30 minutes and it just flowed by. But I've really enjoyed this conversation, Catherine, because it was another reminder for us about that we are leaders in the business and that education and training is still a number one priority for us as we continue to learn and grow, and the value piece that it brings to our business. And, you know, to see you, you know, share the confidence that you've got to have a seat at the boardroom table is so, so important. So thank you for joining me today. Is there any leaving nuggets of gold that you want to share with us or something you'd like to say before we head off to start our day?
I think what did I have here? I think one of the things that I've found really helpful in coming back to Australia after being away for so long was networking. And I really, and I know that Mish, you're an absolute queen in the networking space.
Well, that's how we met, didn't we?
That's exactly right. And I think that some of the most beautiful friendships that I've had and make and nurture and still have since I came back from working overseas is the network and mm-hmm. through the network. And I would encourage listeners to do that, to join organisations, to join groups, to make an effort in that space, because it brings you rewards that go far and beyond your actual role. Mm-hmm. It really is about sustaining those beautiful friendships, which and having them as true friendships, which is really something that I'm very grateful for. And I'm very grateful to have met you, and I'm really, really, really proud of what you're doing, and
Thank you. And
support it fully. And I'm excited to see what's going to partake in on January 18.
I know. It'd be good to. I'd like to say that we'll see each other before Christmas, but if we don't, I'll see you face to face at the gala ball, which is going to be great. We get to frock up, and and I think also just to celebrate. It has been a really hard 2 years for our profession. I mean, so many job losses, and, I'm excited to see there is a candidates market at the moment for people looking for roles. But just to be able to sit in a room and go, wow, we've made a difference. And, and to see whoever the finalists are and also celebrate those winners, it's just going to be incredible. So if I don't see you, have a lovely Christmas. Thank you for joining me today and on your first live. And to everyone... We've still got a few days left if you want to nominate your admin superstar. And yet again, if you want to reach out to Catherine or any of the advisory panel members that we've interviewed, just to talk to them about the profession, if you're looking for a mentor as well, reach out. We can have that discussion with you, because having someone in your life, or having, as you said, that community mm-hmm. around you to support you, you need it, because it can be very lonely at the top.
Yes.
Yes. So have an incredible day, everyone, and we'll see you all soon.
Take care, everyone.